All right, hello, and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP, online sales magazine, and Pipeliner CRM, joining you as usual from San Diego. And today I'm delighted to be joined by Chuck Cooper, who is the other side of the country in North Carolina. How are you doing, Chuck?
I'm doing great. It's good to be with you, John.
Yeah, and Chuck is a managing member at Whitewater Consulting and in North Carolina. And throughout your career, you've been involved with the ownership level with several small and mid-sized companies, and also extensive experience working in the PEO industry. But you have a passion for working with leadership and small and mid-sized companies, helping them design and define their HR strategies that eliminate the fear, uncertainty, and doubt that have made it, that often come with solving people problems. And what we're going to talk today about is a rather large and probably not a extensively discussed topic, I think. I think it's one that's been kind of brushed over, but that is how has COVID and the pandemic, how has that impacted the mental health of employees? So first off, Chuck, would you agree that this is a subject that perhaps has not gotten the attention that it probably deserves?
Absolutely. And I think that's one of the greatest side effects to COVID has been the impact on mental health. And it has forced its way to the forefront and to the spotlight for a lot of consultants, as well as people within the US that are talking about this topic.
Yeah. And let's face it, I mean, it's a topic that in general, I mean, putting even aside the pandemic, it's a topic for some reason that we still have difficulty talking about. Like, you know, it's like people are very comfortable like coming forward and saying, you know, I got this illness or that illness, you know, when it's a physical thing. But when it comes to mental illness, we still have somewhat of a stigma of actually coming forward with an issue like this. So that kind of exacerbates the problem.
It really does. And I think that, you know, it's that that negative stigma that is attached to mental health that has really prevented a lot of people from coming forward in the past. I know when we looked at some studies recently, when we looked at the number of people that were actually impacted by mental health going back before COVID, there was about, if I remember right, around 32 million people within the US that were impacted by mental health concerns. As we've gone through the pandemic, that number has now grown to close to about 180 million people within the U.S.
Wow, I mean, those are frightening statistics. So, Chuck, you're saying that the numbers have gone up to 180 million of people affected in the States by mental health issues, and obviously it's probably comparable throughout the world. So how do companies start to broach this subject and actually make it, if you like, encourage people to come forward?
I think depending on what level we're looking at, but I think when you look at it from a community standpoint, I think it really does take people within a small group or community to really be willing to come forward and being transparent about the challenges that they may have had or somebody within their family's had, to really kind of break that ice and let people know that it's okay to be, it's okay to not be okay, and to be able to be willing to talk about that. I think the same thing applies to businesses and to leaders today as well. And the fact that I think we've got to be willing to bring the topic up, be willing to have those conversations with our teams, with our managers, and with their team members about how we can address and what we need to do to help address mental health concerns within the country. And I think that, you know, there's a lot of benefits that are available. The reality is, a lot of times the people within our businesses, they just don't know that those resources are there.
Yeah, no, I would agree. I would say that a lot of people don't know that those resources are there. They probably don't even look at that part of their medical benefits. They probably don't even read up on that part. Again, probably because, you know, they don't want to draw attention. But also, I guess that's the other part, is if you are to come forward and you are to take advantage of the benefits, I guess sometimes there's probably a fear that, although we have HIPAA laws and all of that, there's a fear that this is going to somehow impact you, or people are going to find out, etc.
I think that, you know, it's a fear of how am I going to be viewed from my manager, or from my, in some cases, just from within my neighbors. But I think when you, if you focus this conversation on the work side, it really does come down to they're just really fearful that they will be passed over maybe for a promotion. If they ask for some time off, that they may be viewed as someone that's not committed to the company.
Yeah, and I think that's, as we said at the beginning, I mean, I think that's the crux of it, where we have to start to change the attitudes. Because, you know, like I said at the beginning, if I was to say to you as my manager, oh, I have to take time off because I broke my leg or something like that, you'd be like, oh, that's terrible. I'm sorry to hear about that. Yeah, that's fine. But if I said, I need some time off because I've gotten to get my head together and I'm seeing somebody and all of that, the reaction, as we said, is often a little bit different. And we have to square those.
Yeah, we do. And I think that, you know, from a leadership standpoint, not only being transparent and bringing this topic up with our team, but it's also being able to model some of the things that we can do as companies to help provide some additional resources for the employees to be able to take advantage of. And a couple of items that we really need to focus on. We are so, when you look back over the last year, we've had everybody working from home, living at home, trying to educate their kids from home. And there's been a lot of stress that's come from that. So being able to identify ways that we can reduce some of those stress loads, for those work from home employees, I think is really important. And part of that is encouraging our team to take time away, to unplug from technology, or to go away on vacation and be willing to, even if you're staying at home, to be able just to unplug and not be responsible for phone calls and for emails that are coming in. And I think we have to model that as leaders to our team.
Yeah, no, there's a couple of things I wanted to come back on. What you just said is, I think you just said some really important things. I think the first one there is about the working environment. And let's face it, there's probably going to be a lot of people who stay working remotely because, I think the pandemic has shown up that there is little reason, in many jobs, there's little reason to actually have to travel to a physical location. But that also requires some flexibility on behalf of the employer. And I think this is the part where we need that communication, because maybe your setup at home isn't ideal, or maybe, you have small kids and all of that kind of stuff. So maybe we have to redefine what working hours are and things like that, and be more flexible around those.
Yes, establishing boundaries between managers and their employees as far as what expectations are.
Yeah, and if that means that somebody works in the evening as opposed to early morning, they work later because early morning there's a bunch of things to do with kids. But I think that we have to be, flexible in that. And there's another interesting point that you also raised there. And it's culturally quite an American thing, coming from Ireland, I can observe both sides. But I mean, culturally in America is, taking time off for vacation, it's kind of not celebrated. It's kind of like, okay, I guess you have to take some time off. The always on, because mm-hmm. I'm always on your emails, your phone, all of those things. So it's a lot of pressure here. In other countries, I think they, and certainly in Europe, vacation is looked on a little bit differently. But so do you think in the US we need to start to modify a little bit how our attitude to time off, to vacation, to switching off, to recharge, as you said?
I think that's going to be a great first step. And I think that, again, as we look at studies going back pre-pandemic, even just within the US, American workers left over 700 million days of unused PTO on the books in 2018. And so I think that gives us a little bit of insight as to really a concern, because we are so focused on, we've got to always be on, we've always got to be working, not taking time away. And so that has led to, even before the pandemic, this has led to the trend of continuing to have a growing number of people affected by anxiety, by depression, and the mental health concerns that we are working through today. So I think that's another piece that we really got to be able to focus on. And again, it starts with leadership and with managers being able to model that to their employees.
Yeah, because I mean, I couldn't agree with you more. Because let's face it, I mean, if you were, you know, had a lot of sick days or whatever, the company would probably look at it and say, "Are you okay? What's going on? Can we help you?" Whatever. But if you have like 90% of your leave unused, nobody's going to say anything to you unless you live in a state or the company has a policy where you use it or lose it or whatever, and the state allows you to do that. But do you think that that's something that people, you know, like managers and HR should be looking at and saying, oh, you know, Chuck hasn't taken any leave or very little leave. You know, maybe we need to talk to him about taking some time out.
And it comes back to that personal relationship and knowing your people. Because as managers and including HR, we should be able to see when there's starting to be some changes in the behaviors and the actions of our team members. And I think that we do need to be encouraging them to utilize more of the PTO to be able to get away. I've recently talked with some business owners, and they're adopting this model of they're encouraging their employees to take time. And when they do go away, they're actually cutting off their emails and cutting off any type of phone service through cell phones that they have through the company. So they're trying to force their people to actually break away and to be able to focus on downtime. So that when they come back, they are rejuvenated, they're refreshed, and they're ready to, you know, to be able to move forward. The other thing that we've got to take into account is that when those people go on vacation and they come back, there's such a workload the first couple of days when they get back that sometimes we may have hundreds of emails to try to go through. And we've got to figure out a way to be able to disperse some of that workload so that when you come back, you can work, you know, you can basically hit the ground running, but not be overwhelmed by the work that's there for you.
Yeah, and let's face it, I mean, that's the reason why a lot of people don't switch off, because, you know, when you're on vacation, you don't want to come back to this huge mountain of stuff. So people go, well, if I just do an hour every day, that'll clear the backlog. Unfortunately, as we know, that hour every day, something crops up, an issue crops up, and before you know it, either you're distracted completely because you're trying to fix this, or you're running around and suddenly 1 hour turns into several hours and you're no longer really on vacation.
Right. And I think, you know, again, it comes back to knowing your people. There's folks that I talk to that they can break away from a Friday, or they may do a long weekend and they can come back and feel completely refreshed. There's others, by the time they get to day two or three, they're just beginning to unwind and starting to see the value of taking time away. So again, they may need to take longer stretches. They may need to take that week or 10 days to get away. But again, it comes back to really knowing your people and also at this point, training your managers within the companies to be able to identify when they need to encourage employees to take those kind of steps.
On the subject of identify, how are some of the ways that managers and companies can recognize perhaps that people are, you know, are showing signs of burnout or stress or mental health issues?
I think we've got to start with training. So we really do need to bring somebody in that's got some expertise in burnout and mental health and help educate our managers on some of those signs that they need to be aware of. And then from the next step, I believe, is we've got to be able to take away some of the administrative burden that's on those managers, so that they can really focus more on the individuals and on their team from a personal standpoint. Because whether you've got somebody working in the office or if you've got somebody working at home, you've got to be able to manage them a little bit differently just because of the different environments that they're working in. But at the end of the day, you've got to be able to know your people well enough and to be able to see that maybe they are not as engaged with in meetings, whether it's virtual or whether it's in person. Maybe they're responding completely different emotionally than what they normally would. So it's not just seeing the basics, but it's really taking that to the next step and being able to see and getting to know your people well enough that you can almost proactively make the recommendation that they need to take some time away.
Yeah, no, I think those are great points. And like you said, I mean, it comes down to knowing your people. And I think probably one of the things that the pandemic has shown most is the need for more communication and really good communication and understanding, because when people are virtual, you really do need to understand their circumstances. And so, I mean, that requires a conversation. And even if people are coming back into the office now, I think it probably behooves management to check in with each individual and just see even if the transition back into the office maybe causes some issues.
And we're talking with a lot of business owners and HR managers today that they are looking at, you know, bringing their people back in, starting very, very soon over the next couple of months. And there are there is a percentage of those employees that are saying we're not comfortable coming back in. And so we're encouraging our clients then to take that next step to meet with those employees one-on-one and find out where is that line or that threshold from where they feel comfortable to where they don't feel comfortable, and see if there's ways that they can adjust the working environment for them.
Yeah, and I also think that it also is incumbent on companies to look at, what are the benefits of people working remotely? Like, does it allow them to have a better quality of life if they have the right setup and if their job or role allows them to do it? Does it allow them to have more family time? Does it eliminate, expensive and lengthy commutes and dead time? Do you need to spend all this money, bringing people into the office? So I think companies have to take a good hard look. And as you say, look at different employees and actually say, am I getting more out of them because they're at home? So do I need to actually embrace that and help them set up the optimum environment?
I think as we look at studies, again, going back over the last year, I think that it shows that the employees are actually working more hours. And they're actually more productive working from home than they were working in the office. So I can't say that working from home is a fit for everyone, but for certain departments, certain individuals, it definitely is more productive for them to be working from home than it is coming to the office.
Yeah, and in that way, I think then companies have to figure out, okay, if people are going to work at home, how can we help them set up the optimal environment, how can we make sure that we understand the arrangements and the communications and all of that, but be proactive about it. Cause I feel a lot of companies are not proactive about it. Like they will say, okay, yeah, it's fine, Chuck, you can work at home, but that's as far as they take it. And then but there's no guidelines around it. There's no, checklist of, what is an optimum setup. There's no setting expectations. And that always leads to problems.
All of those things are very, very important things for business owners as well as HR managers to be focused on. And that is where most of them are focused right now. They know that a year ago they were caught flat-footed when it came to the pandemic and having to send everybody home to work because they had no policies or procedures, no technology in place to really be able to support their employees. Now they know that going forward, they've got to be prepared for that. And I think more people are starting to look toward the future of work, meaning that there is going to be more growth in the gig economy, as well as people working, outside of not only outside the office, but maybe even outside of the state, or even in some cases in different countries, working for jobs in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. A very good point, because I do think that the nature of work is changing and will continue to change, because there's a lot of work has gotten very complicated, and there's a lot of things that require a specific expertise, and that expertise is not always needed full time. Therefore, I think, to your point, I think we're going to see hybrid organizations in the future, a lot of remote working, a lot of contractors or whatever, but they're going to have to be able to kind of seamlessly slide them in and slide them out as needed. And a lot of that takes a philosophical shift on behalf of the company to embrace, gig workers or part-time workers or contractors or remote workers.
All of those things are certainly, on the table. And I think that as I've talked with business owners that have, were able to successfully pivot last year and to start to address some of these areas, those business owners were typically part of a peer group or some type of a business like-minded community. That really helped them work as a sounding board to help them kind of talk through those different areas and topics and make some decisions in a very quick manner so that they could make that pivot and become really successful in 2020 versus those business owners that were sitting in their offices in a silo. They were really late to making those pivots. And so they're still trying to recover in many cases today.
Yeah, and as we said, getting back to the mental health aspect, I do think that actually taking a proactive approach to people's working environments is something that can help, and something that people should do. So, just lastly, Chuck, if you are an employee and you're struggling mentally a little bit right now, how would you advise them to approach their company?
I think first, oftentimes we have somebody within the company, whether it's another employee or our manager that we have a connection with and we feel close to. The one thing that I would say is do not hold back and go forward, have those conversations with your manager to talk about what really the challenges you're facing, what you're feeling, and then ask for help as far as what resources they may have available, whether it's through an EAP or maybe it's even mental health benefits through their benefit package, but just try to get clarity around the resources that you have. And I think that's probably the greatest, the first step that really needs to be taken. We've got to take that stigma away, and we've got to feel comfortable coming forward to get help. And I think as companies, we are much more open to that, and we will certainly do everything we can to help provide the resources and get our employees the help they need.
Yeah, absolutely. Listen, thanks, Chuck. This has been great. All of Chuck's information is going to be below this video. But before we go, Chuck, do please tell us a little bit more about yourself and Whitewater Consulting.
Well, thank you. First, John, it's been great to be with you today. Whitewater Consulting is a company that I started a few years ago, and we really are a business consulting practice that specializes in human resources, where we work with small to mid-sized businesses across the U.S. And that means really working with companies from 10 to 15 employees up to as large as about 400 employees. But we are a connector. We are able to work with our clients and help them to identify the challenges they have with regards to their people, and then find solutions providers that we can introduce them to help fill those gaps for our clients. So that's really where our heart and our passion is.
That's fantastic. Listen, thanks again, Chuck. My name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine, Pipeliner, CRM. I will see you all for another interview really soon. Thank you.